Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, July 29th, 2018. This is the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. We'd like to thank everybody that helped at our booth at the Clark County Fair. We had a great turnout. Flowers on the chancel stands are given to the glory of God. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a food pantry. It's open Wednesdays 9 to 10:45. It has an outreach store / thrift store open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table is every Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. Everyone is welcome. Last week we had our Christmas in July where we helped replenish the shelves in the food pantry. The congregation donated 500 pounds of food and $300 in cash. St. John's annual picnic is coming up on August 12th at 12:30 at C.J. Brown Reservoir. Our organist is Greg Nolte. We don't have a choir during the summer. It will start up after Labor Day. We have an 8 o'clock service at the Melody Cruise Drive-In Theater on 40 east of Springfield. Labor Day weekend, that Sunday, we have a pet blessing. Bring your pets and come and they will be blessed. Thank you for joining us today. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by the Lord, therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We begin our worship with come, we that love the Lord, hymn number 625, in the back of your worship, hymn number 625.
Thank you.
glory to the Lord.
Church and in Jesus Christ to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Just as long, like streams.
When it comes to working for the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ, unfortunately there are many people, and maybe you're one of them, who feels that you are too insignificant and too poor to do anything to help in the proclamation of the gospel. When I say too insignificant and too poor, I'm not talking about physical abilities or intellectual or material. I'm talking about you feel insignificant or you feel poorly in your spiritual life or in the spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit has given you to use to the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. In our gospel lesson, our reading for today from that sixth chapter of the gospel according to St. John, we have a message of assurance and encouragement for each of us, no matter what our gifts, our abilities may be, and no matter what we might think of ourselves. Turning ourselves over to Christ, as the lad in the gospel reading turned his lunch over to Jesus, we will be amazed at what Christ can do. Because Jesus Christ can make much out of little. As we review our gospel lesson, we go back to that sixth chapter of John and to the ninth verse. Jesus is asked, Philip, what they're going to do, all these people showing up. Philip says, 6 months' wages wouldn't pay for these people. Of course, Jesus is putting him to the test, and he's failed. Then Andrew says, well, Lord, we got a little boy here. He's got his lunch with him. 5 loaves and 2 fish. The scholars say those loaves are about the size of an average pancake, not a big flapjack that falls on your plate, but a normal size pancake, not a real fluffy one like I was supposed to have at the restaurant the other day. They were so flat, instead of bringing you 3 fluffy pancakes, they brought me 6 flat pancakes to make up for the 3 flat pancakes. So it was something like that. And so Andrew said, oh, here is wage, but what is this going to do? Once again, we see the disciples who've been traveling to Jesus, who've been seeing Jesus perform these miracles. He sends them out on their own mission, 2 by 2, and they've healed people, and they've cast out demons, and yet they still don't comprehend who Jesus is and what Jesus can do. Instead of Andrew with confidence bringing that little boy and said, Jesus, here's this boy's lunch. I'm sure that you have the power to enable this to be done. Instead, they're dead. They don't realize that Jesus made much out of little. So, likewise, we may be small spiritually. We may be small in the spiritual gifts that we have. But when we have trust and faith in Jesus, He can take us and do marvelous things. We may have very little to offer financially, materially, intellectually, or spiritually. But what we have is Jesus Christ. It may be something that Jesus has to do, or it may be something as simple as saying the right word at the right time in the right place. For example, England versus the church. The Church of England. What we know is the Anglican Church. So in England, there is no problem with teaching the Christian faith in the public schools because you support the state church. Same way throughout the most European countries have state churches. And so one day in a classroom in London, a teacher was teaching a class about the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. For those of you who are good biblical scholars, you know that this is the only miracle that appears in all 4 Gospels. Every Gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all after she tells the story as it is, she begins to give a rational, logical, reasonable understanding or interpretation of the parable. And this is what she says, quote, "Of course, you will understand, children, that it does not actually mean that Jesus fed all those people with such a small amount of food. That would be impossible. It means that he fed the people with his teaching so that they lost all sense of bodily hunger and went home satisfied." Well, that explanation didn't sit right with the little girl in class, so she immediately raised her hand. She asked the teacher this question. She said, "But teacher, what was it that filled those 12 baskets afterwards if it wasn't really food? What was it that you did?" Today, atheists, agnostics, enemies of the church, opponents of the church, use the same tactic. They try to explain away the miracles of the Bible, whether it's the Old Testament, like we read today, Elisha feeding 100 people, whether it's Noah building the ark, whether it's a Tyre battle, whether it's the crossing of the Red Sea, or in the New Testament, the miracles of Jesus. They try to explain them away with reason and logic and what they think is inevitable. And so we constantly have to fight this battle, because we are defending God's word. We are defending the Bible. Someone asked one time, what made Billy Graham so successful as a preacher? And the person replied, one, he was very charismatic. The second was, when he preached, he always emphasized the Bible says, so that people knew he was not giving his opinion, but what God was saying. So the enemies will attack and attack. And the sad thing is, there are theologians in the church that do the same thing. We don't hear much about it anymore, but at one time, it was back in the 80s or 90s, there was this real popular group called the Jesus Seminar. And they would gather together, and they would look at the Gospels, and they would read about what Jesus did, and they would have little marvels. Any of y'all in the fraternity or sorority remember how you voted on new members? You had a black ball, a white ball, and you had this box you'd go around and put one ball over the other end. And depending on the fraternity or sorority, what the rules were. Mine was, if a candidate got two black balls and 30 white balls that didn't have two black balls around. Well, they were voting, not using scholarly research, but voting on whether Jesus did this or that. Either he said it and did it, or maybe he said it and did it, probably didn't say it good, or absolutely did not say it good. And they would print a new version of the Bible with everything out of the Bible that they thought Jesus didn't really do or say. Why do we need atheists and agnostics attacking the Bible in our own scholars? But that is what the enemies do. When I was in my senior year in high school, I took a humanities class. And I don't remember why, but for some reason, one day in class, we were discussing reading the Exodus event. We were examining the miracle, how Moses had this staff. It would bloom, and he put it on the ground and turn into a snake. He held it up, and the Red Sea parted, and when it parted, the sea closed in on the Egyptians. We talked about all the different plagues. We talked about Moses took that same staff, tapped a rock, water came out, manna in the morning, quail in the evening for the people to and say, well, this plague happened because it just so happened that red clay fell into the Nile River and stream and it came down. Well, how did that cause water in vessels to turn into blood? They weren't from the Nile River. They were already in the picture of water. And they had an excuse for the locusts and everything else. And then, of course, the excuse for crossing the Red Sea. Well, it wasn't really the Red Sea. It was this marsh here called the Reed Sea. And the wind had been blowing, so it kind of dried it out. They went over it. And that didn't explain how the Egyptians would drown in a marsh that suddenly just became wetted. The chariots may not have been bad, but they wouldn't have drowned. They would have been body forced upon the shore. Then he tried to make up his spell. I had enough. I raised my hand. And I said, Mr. And I'm not going to use his name. Let the guilty stay unknown. You wouldn't know him anyhow, but still. But I said, Mr. So-and-so, I said, why are you doing this? And the school I went to was 40% Jewish and 60% not Jewish. The class, this man's class, had several Jewish students in it, and the majority of us were Roman Catholic and Protestant. So I said, why are you trying to explain this away? I said, for those of us in the class who believe this story, for whom this story is sacred, part of our faith tradition, we believe what is written. We believe everything happened as it's described. For those in the class who don't believe, they don't need your explanation because they don't believe it didn't happen. They don't believe it ever happened. They believe it's all made up. So why are you trying to rationalize what God can do? And that ended the discussion. But going back to the little girl, see, this is going back to this point that Jesus makes much out of it. That little girl's innocent question. The teacher then, what filled those 12 baskets afterward if it wasn't food? Bothered the teacher. And she began to wrestle with that question. And she began to wrestle with why she doubted God's word. And so, just like we confess in the explanation to the third article of the Creed, that the Holy Spirit calls us through the gospel and enlightens us with its gifts, enlightens us with its gifts, the Holy Spirit began to call her. And she read more and more of the gospel, and she became a Christian, all because of a little third grade asked a simple question. If it wasn't really food in those baskets afterwards, it was. Jesus can make much out of it. And so we have to leave every opportunity open. Not think of ourselves as insignificant, but realize God in Christ has going to use us for something. Second thing we learn from our gospel lesson is to give our all to Christ. Verse 11, Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. As the church continues to witness to a modern world, especially here in America at least, there seems to be a turning away from the true spiritual aspect of believing in Jesus Christ and using Jesus more as a justification for one's own biases, one's own prejudices, one's own agendas, and one's own selfish goals, instead of proclaiming Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of the world, instead of proclaiming Jesus Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and a folly to Gentiles. That's the message. But today we're not always hearing that. We see people trying to use Jesus for their own advantage. The young boy gave everything to Jesus without resurrection. He didn't hand his lunch to Jesus. And Jesus, can I keep a loaf and a fish for myself? He didn't say, Jesus, am I going to give anything himself and his lunch to Jesus to take little and turn it into much. And that is what we are supposed to. We are supposed to commit ourselves to Jesus and let him do this for you. But oftentimes today we see people say, well, I want to follow Jesus, but what will I get in return? Or I want to follow Jesus if he makes sure I receive that promotion. Or he enables me to be successful at this sale. Or he lets me buy that big house I've always dreamed of. Or buy that fancy car. They come with all these temporal things that once they're gone, they can't take with them. Once they're gone, they'll go to somebody else. Or be burned up, thrown away, whatever. Instead of coming to Jesus and saying, thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. Dying on that cross, paying the debt of sin that I owe, giving me forgiveness and a promise of everlasting life. But they want more. What greater gift is there than that? To know that when you wrong, you're forgiven, that you had a promise of everlasting life. You don't have to worry about, can I earn it? Have I done enough to earn that salvation? We give our all to Christ as a response to the love that God has first shown us. God loved us so much he gave his only son so that whoever believes in him should not perish. He loved us so much that he sent his son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. What more could we want? It's free. Simply for believing. We don't have to earn it. We don't have to make special sacrifices. We don't have to go through all kinds of rules and regulations. It's just given to us through faith in Jesus Christ. Yet there are those who want something in return, something physical. It's just like some worship today. Some people totally do not understand what worshiping God means. They think it means coming to be entertained. They think the show is supposed to be put on for them. That's not worshiping God. Worshiping God is coming with a thankful heart to thank and praise him for the gift of his Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. To come humbly and meekly to him and say, Lord, I am not worthy. Only say the word, and I will be healed. That is what worship is about. That is committing yourself to Jesus totally. Now, why do some people have this misconception about what committing to Jesus means? Then it goes all the way back to a misunderstanding of the nature of God. To understand that, you have to go back to the third chapter of the very first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. And if you're familiar with the book of Genesis, you know that the third chapter contains what we call the fall. It's a theological term for it. When humanity fell away from God, he rebelled against God, and unleashed sin into the world. It's a story of Adam and Eve going to the garden one day, and along comes a serpent, and the serpent starts to tell, oh, did God really say this? God really say that? If you eat of that fruit from the tree, good and evil, he's not going to kill you. And instead, when your eyes will be open, you will be like God. Of course, that appealed to Adam and Eve. Yeah, they would be like God. So they ate of the forbidden fruit. Their eyes were open, as the Bible says, and they realized they were naked, and so they went to hide. Well, it's the cool of the afternoon, and along comes God walking in the garden. He doesn't see Adam and Eve like normally being in the garden and enjoying the garden. He goes, Adam, where are you? Now, when you read God's question, If your attitude is that God is asking that question like a policeman, asking somebody why they violated the law, then your concept of God is all wrong. And no wonder you don't understand what the commitment of Jesus Christ is, that it's not a bargaining tool, it's not to gain material things, it's giving your life to Christ in faith. But when you hear God say, Adam, where are you? And you realize he's saying it in the voice of a broken-hearted father looking for a lost child, you understand the nature of God. God was broken hearted. He wasn't angry. He wasn't coming into the garden full of wrath and vengeance. He didn't berate Adam and Eve. He was broken-hearted that they had rebelled against him. He had given them everything they needed. They liked nothing. And we're no different today. God has given us salvation in Jesus Christ, yet we still want more. We will not give our all to Jesus like that little bull gave all his lunch. Confidence and hope in what Jesus could do. So when we understand God sent Jesus because his heart was broken, that we are his lost children, we understand his truth. So what do? We rejoice over what God has done in Christ. And verse 12, and when they had eaten their fill, he told the disciples, gather up the leftover fragments that nothing may be lost. So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, this is indeed the prophet who is coming into the world. They were rejoicing. They were celebrating. And that is what we rejoice in what Christ can accomplish. Making much out of it. Out of 5 loaves and 2 fish came 12 basketful of leftovers. A miracle. But God is a God of miracles. In this incident, we see the implication of many major themes of the Christian faith. The sitting down of the people together and giving bread is a symbol or foreshadowing of the Eucharist. The coming together as brothers and sisters in Christ around the table of our Lord to receive his body. The gathering up of the scattered pieces that were left over is a foreshadowing of the evangelizing mission of the church. God wants no one left behind, so we're to go to all the scattered lost sheep throughout the world and share with them the good news of the gospel. The miracle, of course, emphasizes the messiahship of Jesus, that Jesus is indeed the Son of God, was sent to be the Savior of the world. And so we are not to be concerned about what happened and how it happened. We're simply to believe. We believe that Christ can make much out of it. The great evangelist Charles Spurgeon was walking down the street one day in England, in a town in England, and a seminary student came up to him and was all upset and befuddled and not knowing what to do with himself, and told Mr. Spurgeon, he said, that there was this Bible passage that he had, and he could not for the life of him figure out the meaning of it. And it had him so perplexed and upset that he could not understand the meaning. So calmly and firmly, but compassionately, Mr. Spurgeon replied to him, and he said, young man, allow me to give you a word of advice. Give the Lord credit for knowing things you don't understand. Give the Lord credit for knowing things you don't understand. Give the Lord credit for his son on the third day, and 40 days later had him bodily ascend into heaven, even though we don't understand. Give the Lord credit for turning 5 loaves of bread into fish into a meal for 5,000. But we don't understand. Because if we could, then Christ would be no different than ourselves. The great American orator, served as senator back in the days, and then, I don't know how many of y'all realize this, but it wasn't until the early part of the 20th century, I believe it was, that we didn't vote for senators. The state legislature voted for the senator. And that's why in the 1800s, you didn't have senators who had been a senator for 30 or 40 years. Because every time the governor changed, he had his own idea who he wanted to be senator, his own friends, the old senator. So, Henry Clay, the great compromise, only served like a one term or two in the Senate because the governor changed, the legislature changed. It was an amendment made sometime in the early 20th century that brought the electing the senators by the people. So we had these guys stay here for 40 years, way beyond they should have liked. Yeah, Thurman was 90-something years old when his family retired. Anyhow, Daniel Webster was at a dinner one night, and he and his friends began a discussion about Jesus Christ. And some of the friends were kind of doubters, and they asked Daniel Webster, they said, "Can you comprehend how Jesus is both God and man?" And Daniel Webster replied, "No, sir," he said, "I cannot comprehend how he is both God and man. Because if I could, then he would be no different than me. And I believe I'm in a superhuman savior." That is letting God know more than we know. So we can't explain it. It's just like the Trinity. You drive yourself crazy trying to explain the doctrine of the Trinity to a point where you really understand how one God is three in one, but still is just one God. That's both God. That's more. And so from our gospel lesson today, remember, you're not insignificant. You're not poor. Because Jesus can make much out of you. All we have to do is let God be God and let Jesus Christ be Jesus Christ. Stand back and marvel at all that can be done through the power of Jesus Christ. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Let us now sing the first 4 verses. I think it's 7 or 8 on the page. The first 4 verses of hymn number 634, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." Hymn number 634.
105 at the front of your worship book. And again, inviting those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as with the whole church. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, the Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He was ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Due to the number and length of petition this morning, please be seated for prayers. Let us pray to the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, on behalf of the church, the world, and one another. Our response today is to hear our prayer. Most holy God, you have rooted and grounded the church in the life-giving body of your dear Son. Use it to feed, heal, teach, and draw many people to the foot of Jesus' cross. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Shelter and bless all who suffer greatly on account of naming Jesus as Lord, especially our sisters and brothers in Syria, Pakistan, North Korea, and Iraq. By their faithful endurance and charity, soften the hearts of their enemies and bring many to repentance and salvation. Use our your missionaries to feed many hearts with the word of life and salvation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Nourish the people of this congregation with the living bread of heaven. Heal us with your compassion and forgiveness. Give us boldness to proclaim your saving love to those around us who need to hear it most. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bless our young adults with lively faith and the strength of character to resist the fads and follies of the culture. Channel their energy and idealism to accomplish deeds of mercy and words of wisdom. Use them to introduce skeptical and cynical co-workers to you, the source of all goodness, truth, and beauty. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Give to those entrusted with leadership in government, justice, education, industry, or the arts, upright and honest hearts. Teach them to love wisdom, justice, and mercy. Grant them through their proper use of authority all people may receive the blessing of food, health, safety, opportunity, and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for police, firefighters, first responders, our military, and all the unsung heroes who risk their lives on behalf of liberty, justice, and safety. Give them the wisdom, courage, and integrity they need to do their jobs faithfully and well. Help us to honor their service and sacrifice, and give them new opportunities to benefit their communities when their present duties are completed. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bestow your Holy Spirit upon all who cry out to you for help. Graciously help, heal, restore, and strengthen them. Bless everyone who assists them in their time of need, and increase their faith and trust in you, their strength, and their Redeemer. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Keep in your tender care, dear Father, all who have died trusting in your promises, especially those whose loss we feel most deeply. Heal our grief, strengthen our faith, and forgive our sins of doubt, despair, or bitterness. Nourish us with the bread of life, and refresh us with your Holy Spirit, and lead us into your heavenly kingdom, where with all the redeemed we shall rejoice in your goodness forever. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Hear and graciously answer our prayers, dear Lord, as it is best for us and most glorifies your holy name. Amen.
Amen. It's time for our offering. John and Karen Dietrich are our ushers today and will be collecting the offering.
Thank you.
That concludes our service for today. Again, we have the food pantry on Wednesdays, 9 to 10:45 a.m. We have the outreach store open 9:30 to 1, Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table every Friday from noon to 1. The 8 o'clock service is celebrated at the Melody Cruise Drive-In Theater on 40 East of Springfield at 8 o'clock. Please join us. Service held, rain or shine, again 10:30 in the sanctuary at St. John's Lutheran Church at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Enjoy the day.